Ron Keel, the Metal Cowboy, and you're watching Decibel Geek TV. Crank it up and keep it up.
Decibel Geek TV presents the Kuhn Brothers Rockcast. And here's your host, Pete and Jim, the Kuhn Brothers.
Yes, welcome to episode number 2 to the Kuhn Brothers.
We are back! We made it past 1.
I'm Jim.
And I'm Pete. We're the Kuhn Brothers.
Right on. This is Pod Rockcast. Let's call it a Rockcast number 2. And if you haven't noticed by now, number 1 is back up and rocking. And we want to thank you all for visiting our first premiere episode that got banned about 12 hours after we put it up. And that wasn't because I said dirty words, because he wasn't wearing the right makeup.
It had nothing to do with that. It was copyright
issues. I'm actually copyrighted, and I didn't go through my people.
No, it had nothing to do with that.
What was it?
So you guys who have joined Decibel Geek TV, as far as our Facebook page and on YouTube, you got to see all 100 and...
You guys, there was like 110 views
in 2 days.
In 1 day.
A day?
In 24 hours.
Thank you guys.
Awesome.
That's so cool. And everybody who's told other people about it, we really appreciate
that.
And
we know 60 of you were our friends and 40 of them were me. But thank you so much anyway for watching.
He has 40 different names on Facebook.
I went around work and I went to every cubicle at work.
His nickname is Catfish. Catfish Hunter.
So
thank you guys for watching. We really appreciate it.
Before
it got banned.
Yeah.
And so it did get banned. It's back up.
So watch it again because we need to get back up to that 110. So just like put play, leave the room for a while, and come back. And then it'll count because we need those views.
What won't they see on the edited version, Jim? What won't they see?
They won't see the Sweet video that, you know, Sweet was one of my favorite bands up until about 9 o'clock this morning.
You know what I mean? Rock and Ron, who had to re-edit the whole fucking thing and have it reload for 4 hours. Yeah.
So a band from the early 70s, 60s, 70s, apparently, even though literally half of them are dead, they still have a management company in Germany, and we'll get into that in a second. And they didn't like us promoting them for free.
It's always really good for a band when you promote them for free and you're not making any money off
of
it.
We're not monetized, right? There's no monetization.
No, there's no money going on.
And if there was, it would go to them. It wouldn't go to us. So that's kind of ridiculous.
Because you've been so popular with, you know, the no new music the last 30 years.
So apparently somebody's monitoring the Kuhn Brothers, and I have a feeling it's because I mentioned Alex Jones the other day.
Oh, it's a conspiracy.
It's a conspiracy. So thank you. We want to thank you, and welcome to the second Rockcast. Now, we're going to talk about...
getting banned.
This management company.
Yeah. Okay, so first off, there's a person responsible for banning us, and I don't know who it is, because I googled the company, and the company that did this, and they're called Aviator Management.
Sounds awesome.
Yeah, it sounds really cool, right? Flying high, right? Yeah, they have like three, four bands that
they
go, Jim, they don't represent anybody you'd really care about. So first off, I would do it, but I'm on a bar stool.
Holy
they
shit.
Represent Michael Flatley, Jim.
Michael Flatley?
Yeah.
Holy shit. Never heard of him.
Yeah, you did? Oh, and Rock and Rod's doing the river dance.
Oh,
he knows it. He's the river dance guy.
Okay,
and the other one, Lord of the Dance. He's Lord of the Dance.
He's Lord of the Flies.
Yeah, and so
Michael Flatley
is one of the... Yeah, and so he's been so huge.
Ron, behind the glass back there. Nice work.
Yeah. He represents, okay, so they represent just like the YouTube content. They're not like managing the band. So they represent all the YouTube content for these bands. It's a pretty cool business, I guess. I don't know how you make any money off of it.
But somehow they got notified that we threw up a Sweet video.
Yep. So one of the other things they represent is all the videos from a very recent concert that everybody is super still excited about. I mean,
when was the last time you heard about this?
Yeah, that's it. It's Live Aid.
Oof.
Live Aid was what, 1980? 1983, 1982. Like, no one, I loved Live Aid. Trust me, I was glued to my cable box.
It was actually before.
Because I couldn't turn the channel unless I got up and actually switched the thing.
So it was so long ago that they named it Live Aid. So it was before AIDS came out. That's how old they never named it Live AIDS.
Like AIDS candy.
AIDS
remember?
Diet candy.
Right. Like, that's the worst.
AIDS diet candy.
Worst name ever. It worked. Candy, but. Well, yeah.
Oh, hell yeah.
Killed a lot of people. Lost right. a lot of weight.
So anyway, that's his management fucking company.
So yeah, and the only other person online that they represent that's at all famous at all is Alice Cooper. And so if you post an Alice Cooper video online, beware, because Aviator Management is going to come after you.
So I was thinking about calling these guys up, maybe live, not tonight, but maybe doing a little Jerky Boys action with Aviator Management.
And their CEO and owner named Alexander
Seifer.
Yeah, they're from Germany, so they're from Hamburg, Germany. So it's going to cost us a little fucking cash to call them and be a little jerky.
A little cash. You're doing it right now.
If you guys know who the Jerky Boys are, look them up. We don't have time for that. But they do prank phone calls, and so we thought maybe we'd kind of fuck with them.
So Alexander Seidel's going to get a call from me, and maybe one day you guys will see.
Yeah, so we'll try to plan that for the next episode, because, you know, not cool. We could have easily...
Not cool.
Not cool. We're promoting a band for free.
You know how much money they cost us?
Nothing?
No.
So if you're a management company and you're watching us on Decibel Geek TV right now and you don't want your video played and your band promoted for free, just give us a message and we'll take it off. We'll do something. We don't want to waste our time or Rock and Ron's time promoting your band if you don't want that.
And we don't want to have to berate you when we come back online either.
No, and we,
not cool.
We don't. And we don't want a new segment.
I will. I just don't want to.
We don't want a new segment called Cease and Desist. So, you know.
Or Cease and Desist.
But I do look forward to the jerky call.
Oh, yeah, no.
So,
no.
Alexander.
That's my middle name, too. So, I mean, it's cool. I can call him Alexander because my middle name is Alexander. So, I can make. And I'm kind of German, so I can make fun of him as much as I want.
Ha!
Exactly.
Seidel!
Alexander Seidel!
And if you guys have extra money and you want to look him up and call him for us and just tell him how much you don't appreciate him fucking up our first ever Rockcast,
and
then
throw in.
Look him up, Hamburg, Germany.
Send him an email, toss in a little hit.
You only have to dial like 47 numbers.
It'll be fine, don't worry about it.
All right. So, all right, let's start our second show after berating someone who kind of screwed us over. But again, thank you all for those 100-plus views before we got banned. And obviously, we're back now, so please keep watching it and telling your friends. And befriend us. Tell both your friends. And no, make sure you go to the Decibel Geek TV page and actually like it and follow it. That helps us out, know how many people we're getting to. And then if you want to share it, that's great. But this kind of keeps a meter for us. We know how many people.
It was fun watching you guys like our stuff.
I know.
And
the
make comments
cool.
and the feedback. I dig it. So thanks. All right, let's move on.
Let's move on. Our first segment is... Bum, bum, bum!
Perfect 10! How many of you remember Bo Derek? Holy crap, you're as old as we are.
Yes, that's exactly right.
And now she's a perfect one.
Yes, but we have the perfect 10.
Oh, let me start. Okay.
Jim, start.
Not necessarily perfect 10 songs, but this is a perfect album, baby. Boom. MSG.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing. I was like, does this one have a title? Perfect timing. Schenker, McCauley. This is the first album with Robin McCauley. Playing for Michael Schenker. There's been a lot of MSGs over the years. This one is super fantastic. All these videos are on YouTube. You should check them out for sure. Robin's one of the greatest singers. He's sung with Survivor, with obviously Michael Schenker, with
Robin McCauley Group?
Yeah.
No.
I don't know.
I love Robin's voice, and he's friends with us on Facebook, which I really appreciate that. Really great singer still. We just saw him the MSG tour,
yeah.
And the guy still holds
it's a classic album.
Classic album, good choice. No disagreement there.
And he has fantastic hair back in the day.
Yeah.
So MSG perfect timing. That's one of my perfect tens.
All right. My next perfect 10, or my first one of the day, but my next one from last week, because we had five last week.
Sure.
Just put it up there.
Sure, yeah.
Right there, baby.
Make it bigger, run.
Make it huge. Like, okay, beautiful, and so what's beautiful. Really cool about this one, too, is it's signed to Pete.
Who's it signed by?
Jizzy Pearl, the greatest name in rock and roll.
Jizzy Pearl.
Is there a better name for a rock star than Jizzy Pearl? I don't know.
Blackout in the Red Room, by the way.
That's the big, yeah.
Or,
that's by that's the CD. Listen, that's the CD. The every
track.
Single song,
title
track, title that's
cut.
What they call it. They call it cut.
Title cut.
Yeah. Every single song on this CD is perfect.
It's
for me.
It's tuned down half a step, though. So if you want to jam to it, you got to tune down half a step. Pisses me off.
Bass player.
But I love the album.
Drummers never have to tune down.
No, because they're not musicians. We know this. We've been through this.
I know, it hurts. And so, yeah, thank you very much. Listen to Love Hate. Jizzy's got a solo album just came out, too. It's fantastic. And he has a older one, too, called Just a Boy. But and he's got a couple of books. They're really hard to find. He writes. He's dark. But we met him, and he's really cool. And people think, you know, I was so worried to be Jizzy because... Love Jizzy. And
he does. He loves
I this. Love Jizzy. And I was so worried about him because I thought he was going to be a dick. And I'm like, you don't want to meet a rock star and then that you've loved for years and then they end up being a dick. And then he wasn't. He was super nice and
he
super,
was super
cool. Jim's going to.
That's the one for me.
What you got, buddy?
All right. Here we go. I'm wearing the shirt. Let's put the album up, baby. Steelheart. Their first album, right? Yeah. This is their first album. The second album's just as good as the first. This one is incredible. Guys back in the 80s blew me away, and it was because of their singer. His name used to be called Mike Matijevic or Mike Matijevic, and now his name, he uses his real Croatian name. It is Miljenko. Damn it, I practiced all the way over here. Miljenko Matijevic.
Matijevic. That's better than Matijevic. Yeah.
Mealy, I'm sorry.
Mealy. Sorry, it was Mealy. He's in our phone. Because he's the nicest guy in the world.
No, Mealy's the greatest. I stood next to him when I checked into his hotel room, and he said his name, and I was like, I can't do that. And he's really cool. He wished me a Happy New Year's on New Year's Eve. He's just a sweet guy. Really? And he's got one of the greatest voices in the business, right next to Randy Jackson. These two guys can hit the highs and hit the lows and make you cry. They're wonderful. And Steelheart's still playing right now. This album... and the second album had their drummer, John Fowler, their original drummer, and he passed away after their second album.
Peace, brother.
John's great. But now they're picking back up. They got Mike Humbert playing drums for them. Joe Pesci is their guitar player.
Yeah.
Joe Pesci.
Yeah, you gotta play guitar. No.
He took the fucking baseball bat. It's Joe Pesci. I'm sure he gets it all the time.
Yeah, the guy's great. Yeah.
And the bass player, our friend...
Martin Anderson.
Martin Anderson.
Oh my gosh, Martin Anderson, who's our friend and we love. And just a super nice group of guys.
That's mine. Still
playing still out.
Our rules.
And actually, I had the other one, Tangled in Reins, the second album, in my top ones, but I brought seven, so I'm not going to use it.
Your turn.
I'm not going to use it this time. Because Tangled Reins is just as good.
Fucking snot. Go ahead.
Well, since he's wearing his shirt... promoting his favorite, one of his favorite top 10.
Let's not get too stupid about these guys.
I will do the same. And I was going to save it for last because we have so many stories to tell about this band. Because when bands become friends...
Best friends,
right? I mean, really good friends, it's the greatest thing in the world. I just keep on chasing you. Bingo! Bingo! signed, as you can obviously tell. This was signed in like 1990 or something like that.
When they used to have red shirts.
Before I actually knew them. And now we're really good friends with not just the guys in Babylon.
But their wives and their pets.
Their wives, their sons, their moms. I danced with Jamie's mom, which is a crazy story in itself.
Yeah, let's stop that one right there.
Yeah. The greatest group of guys in the world. But let's get to the music. There's not a song on this fucking album that doesn't rule. And this is one of my mainstays. I go back to this all the time. Every one of their albums, and they've got a new one out. You know, Revelation Highway. They've the second one is incredible.
And it's recorded in natural tuning, so you could play this one from start to finish without taking off your headphones or your bass. Unless you want to switch to Love Hate, then you got to tune down. But no. Zebra and Babylon play natural tuning, and we appreciate that because that means Derek can sing his ass off.
Yeah, and this guy, oh my God, just Derek, and he has some solo stuff. He does some Motown
Derek
stuff.
Davis.
Derek Davis is just look one of the most talented people in the world.
Look him up and follow him.
Look him
on
up and follow him. And everybody in this band is talented. I mean, Ron Freshy, the former guitarist Danny De La Rosa, who's a good friend of ours. Love you, Danny and Holly. sorry, had to do shout outs. You know, you guys.
Yeah,
need to listen to this CD if you've never really, or if you just haven't
bang
bought it.
Bell, baby, bang
but
yeah, bells.
I mean, every single song, Hammer Swings Down, you name it, it's great, and every one of their CDs is great. So, that's why I'm wearing this shirt,
and we got stories with them to tell later.
Oh boy, we have stories.
Okay, my third already.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Let's go pretty quick.
We talked about this last time. This is the Cry of Love's second album, Diamonds and Debris. This one's with Robert Mason. He sings currently for Lynch Mob, Warrant. The guy's all over the place. And he has the best watch collection. He wears Rolexes, Omegas, IWCs. The guy's incredible. But he didn't do it well from this album, because this is a little bit obscure. Unbelievable, though. Greatest vocals, Audley Freed, the guitar player. You might have heard of Audley. He played with the Black Crowes, and he's currently touring with Sheryl Crow.
Sheryl Crow, yeah.
With the bass player for The Cry of Love, Robert Patterson. I might be getting that wrong. I don't want to fuck that up. So, the bass player.
See, your bass players never get any recognition,
even
and
by
he
the
knows
bass player.
That because he's a bass player.
So this song from album from start to finish is absolutely perfect 10. There's an autograph right there.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
It is a perfect 10, I agree.
Rock on.
As is the first one.
With, Cry of Love
with Kelly Holland?
Kelly Holland.
Who?
R.I.P.
Oh, we should have an R.I.P. board up here.
We are going to do a death segment, but we won't talk about that now because that's really
too dark. Too dark this
okay,
world.
Number four.
Number four. All right.
Number three.
All right. So let's go with this one. I could have picked any Junkyard CD in the world. Because they're all incredible in their own right. Every single song. There's not a song I skip on a Junkyard CD. Ever. Two rarities. So those of you guys who know Junkyard, you know they have two unofficial albums out called Triple X and The Joker, and they're really demos. They were never supposed to be released, but there's not a demo off that CD that doesn't rule. So not a bad song off any Junkyard CD. High Water is the brand new one, which is incredible. It just showcases like that they still fucking rule. Love these guys. They're friends of ours as well. Every one of these guys is just an amazing, fun musician who parties.
Oh, they're like, great.
Oh my gosh.
Got some cruise stories with these guys.
We got cruise stories, we got after cruise stories. We love these guys.
Lots of hugs.
And I want to get Todd
Muscat,
the bass player. I want to get him on one of our segments because he has one of the most interesting other jobs
for that other side job. His real career.
Yeah, his real career. Remember we talked about that last week with Drew, and now we're gonna.
Todd's got a great career.
I would love to talk about Todd's other career because I think you'd trip out on that. So Junkyard, any one of their CDs, the first one, this one, the live one, the new one, buy them all because they fucking rule.
Wow.
That's it! I got mad like David Roach right there. I'm a junkyard David Roach.
All right, right here, fellas. My number four, we have four and five left, so bear with us here. Tony Mack, you guys gotta love Tony McAlpine. He's been one of the great. I finally got to see him after like 25 years. One of the greatest greatest guitar player heroes ever. Satriani, Malmsteen. He's in the spirit of them, but better. I mean, Tony's a shit. Maximum Security. This is the album that hooked me. Jeff Watson does a couple songs on this, some solo appearances, guest appearances. And
if you don't know who Jeff Watson is, he's the original Night Ranger. Yep.
George Lynch does some appearances on this one, and this is where I discovered Dean Castronovo, the drummer for another wife beater. We were talking about
wife beater segment last week. So
Dean had some issues.
Allegedly,
but he's
all alleged.
But he's recovered now. Allegedly. So he's great. So he's on this album, and I've never heard him play drums as well on this album than with Journey. He wasn't.
What was the other band? Was it Hardline? Was it Bad English? It was
Bad English.
Bad English. All right. It was another with John Waite. Yeah,
okay. You're number four.
All right, which one should I go? I brought a couple. I get confused. It's very hard for me.
Oh, that's it. I like that.
Want me to do this one?
All right.
I thought you might bring this one.
Ah.
Really?
Ah.
Okay. I almost use this as my obscurity because we have an obscurity segment coming up too. We've heard you guys want segments, and so we're gonna say the
segments.
I don't know if we're gonna actually have segments. But we're just gonna say the word segments as much as we can.
So it puts like a wall in between each part. So we're not yet though. Number four. Show them. Jesus.
This, ladies and gentlemen, is Shotgun Messiah.
Mm.
And they put out three albums. The first one, kind of cool, but different singer. And then they ended up with one that I think was the bass player who became their singer.
You know that one?
You know this probably from Heartbreak Boulevard, and we have a local.
Don't do that.
No, don't sing.
Don't sing.
I was gonna sing. I was gonna try to sing one song every set.
Red Hot. That's better. That's what you should do that one.
Yeah.
You
don't
know that one?
No. Yeah. I can't. I mean, yeah.
Nobody's home. Try that one.
No.
You'll get banned
no,
again if you sing.
Okay, so I guess I'll be banned if I sing.
Because you're saying
I hear it in my ear. My producers. You're getting in a band if you sing anymore, so I guess there's no singing.
The man in the box, behind the glass.
That's right. Not a bad song off this album.
Harry Cody, one of the best guitar players ever.
This album, just a killer rock album with everything going for it. If you don't know it, you're missing out.
Right.
Jim, what do you got for your...
For my fifth perfect 10. You guys, this is as heavy as I get, and I love this shit so much. My boy King Diamond from Merciful Fate, and Ron's gonna put that big, and you gotta take another picture of King, and put that big. I just made more work for my buddy. But check this shit out, Don't Break the Oath. I mean, it's as classic as a heavy metal album can possibly get. If I don't care if you're freaking George Michael or Dimebag Darrell. This is one of your fucking favorite albums.
Wow.
Yeah, you like that? That was pretty good.
Really, you're going like, from the spectrum. Yeah, pretty good.
From Dangerous Meeting to The Oath to, I mean, this is the shit.
Now, he loves King, and I'm not a huge King fan, just like he's not a huge Last Week Clash fan or Def Leppard fan or whatever. Not a huge King
fan.
Best
concert ever you'll ever
Holy
go
shit,
to.
He made me go to the show, and the theatrics and the incredible
the production.
Oh my god, and his wife sings with him.
Lydia, his wife.
She's
gorgeous.
Amazing.
She's the female voice on all of that.
And then we met all the guys outside after the show, and they were super cool, and I'm like, holy shit. Like
Matt Thompson, the drummer, he's from Dallas. Super good guy. Andy LaRocque, the guitar player, he gave his picks. And then these guys are heavy metal Satanists, but they're not really.
No, I'm not Satanists.
Yes. It's an act, just like Striper.
And Ozzy and every other backward mask.
These guys are
dumb.
Alright, that's
great choice. Great choice.
Don't break the oath.
I get to finish this off with my last one.
You get to finish the segment.
The segment. The word segment. Alright, so I'm gonna go with this one. I love Saigon Kick, and oddly enough, they are from the same hometown we grew up in, which is Coral Springs, Florida.
Yeah, Jason.
I didn't know them. They went to the same high school as Jim did. He's younger and went to high school.
I think Jason went to Taravella, and Matt went to Coral Springs.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Wow, that's trippy. Okay, so the two high schools that we went to, there's members of the band. The first album is perfect.
The first album,
Water, is fucking amazing.
And what's the song? Everyone knows. There was a song.
Love it. Oh, you want to sing?
No, the song that ruined metal. Love is on the way,
which is played at every fucking supermarket from Publix to King Supers. Unfortunately, that's kind of how Saigon Kick is known. But if you know Saigon Kick, you know how heavy they are and the riffs they play. And yes, there's another ballad on here, which is incredible. All I Want Is You.
All I Want.
Which I think is actually better. It should have been a bigger hit if you're going to do ballads for that. But you listen to some of their heavy shit like Hostile Youth and
we're old and still living in the 80s, guys. We're old and still living in the 80s.
Yeah.
This is the music you fucking want to listen to, I promise.
So, Phil Barone, drummer, now plays with
both
Bullet Boys and at least Mark Torian's
band. And he had a hell of a side job.
And he probably got a couple of blowjobs too. But a boom.
Hey,
because porn, the porn thing.
I know they don't know that that's what a side job was.
Oh, well, we're not probably going to talk to Phil. All right.
He had a really fun side job, and now he's back in rock.
If we can talk to Phil, we'll talk about his side job and stuff like that. But incredible album, incredible CD whatever release.
And that's our top 10.
That's our top
perfect
10
for
this
top 10.
Week two here. On Decibel Geek TV.
Wrap it up.
Wrap it up.
I'll take it.
One louder.
Why don't you just make 10 louder and make 10 be the top number and make that a little louder?
These go to 11.
Welcome back. That would have been a commercial break right there if we actually had sponsors. You guys didn't realize that because of the smooth editing of our producer, Rockin' Ron. But we are here at Decibel Geek TV.
Studios.
In the studios.
Underneath the tunnels of Denver International Airport.
In the bunker. You're not supposed to talk about that stuff, Illuminati, all that shit, you know. But we're here, and we're gonna, you know what, 10 wasn't good enough.
We know, they saw the video of the Spinal Tap video.
Oh, they're gonna see the Spinal Tap video?
They already saw that?
Oh, okay. So, 10 isn't good enough, so we're going to 11, and, what we're gonna do here is kind of give you an obscurity, something you probably, if you do know this, that's totally cool, we love you. If you don't, maybe it's something you'll check out.
This one I know you guys never heard of. It's a local Arizona guy. His name is Michael Nitro. When I moved to Phoenix, not Nitro, the guitar player like this. Don't start.
Yeah, not
that. When I moved to Phoenix 1993? No, I don't remember. 1990. He was one of the local guys there. Michael Nitro went and saw him in all the local venues, and I think he's still playing today, man. I saw some video on YouTube recently, and although he doesn't look as good as he did back in 1990, do any of us really? So check out some Michael Nitro for my Arizona friends that are seeing this.
It's a band from Philadelphia. There's only two people I've ever met that know who this band is. One of them is Scott Bradley, so Scott, if you're watching, kudos, brother, because, well, he's from Philly, and that's where this band's from. And the other one's a guy named Kid. I was a kid when I met him. His name is Travis.
Well, I know who they are,
too. So, Travis, if you happen to watch this, we've been out of touch for, like, 20 years, so if you happen to be seeing this,
I know who they are, too, so it's three of us.
And Jim knows them because of me. And they're called The Bloody Stools. And their album is kind of a takeoff on Meet the Beatles. It's Meet the Bloody Stools.
Classic.
As you can see here. Classic. Okay, so some of the names of the songs you might know from The Bloody Stools. It's called Choke the Load. And Choke the Load is exactly what you think it would be about. And then Mr. Right, which is a wonderful song. Show Me Your Tits, Steal from the Rich.
Oh, my favorite.
Bump Fuzz.
Yeah.
Bump Fuzz is what you can imagine. It's about two girls getting together. It's a lovely song.
You
didn't
have to explain that. Bloody Stools. But that's
way too much time on the Bloody Stools. Let's get to our next segment. And here comes this really cool graphic for our Guilty Pleasures.
Sexy. Yes, my boy. It's my boy Jack Wagner. Shut up, Peter. If you know what I'm talking about, you'll understand the beauty of this man.
I'm a survivor.
He has four albums out. Now, I know you're thinking about his acting. Is that the guy from General Hospital? Yes. The All I Need guy? Yes. But let me tell you
Frisco Jones.
Jack, honestly, he's also a professional golfer. But without fucking around, I'm being serious. The dude's like the most wonderful musician and singer in the world. I fucking love him to death forever.
Some of you might not consider this a guilty pleasure, and I have other ones that I'll bring up, but I wanted to bring something more mainstream guilty that I listen to all the time, and it also has some relation to what the artist today, what's going on right now, and it's The Outfield. So those of you who are all metal,
another dead guy.
Fucking A, yeah.
John Spinks.
So, I love The Outfield. This album is one of my mainstays as far as pop goes.
I just want to use your love tonight. Oh, I don't want to lose your love tonight.
So that's my guilty pleasure for this week.
Don't hate us.
Yeah, sorry. That's our intro to the Decibel Geek Universe news. All the things that are going on with our fellow podcasters that we love and we want to promote, because we do the video podcast on Decibel Geek TV, but these guys do audio podcasts. So don't think on watching them, plan on listening to them. And they have many platforms that you can catch them on. So we're going to tell you about them right now. Jim, what do you got first?
Well, we got the Decibel Geek podcast. It's the Rockin' Pod Recap from Nashville.
Chris and Aaron, boys, the boys that make this all possible and make Rockin' Pod Expo possible. So, yeah, what do they got going on?
Oh, they're
going
to tell lots of stories.
About?
about all the people that were there and the bands.
Rock and Pod.
Yep, Rock and Pod. And, but they're going to tell you some iffy stories, so some names and faces may have been changed to protect the innocent.
To protect the guilty and innocent.
Faces.
So check them out. These guys rule. So yeah, please check out Chris and Aaron and on the Decibel Geek podcast.
That's right.
Right. We also got the C... So here we go with the acronyms, and I love the way the guys from Cobras and Pyre promoted this. They just gave like 40.
You said I'll do the gang signs, ready?
Yeah. They went like CGG by Guju Life 746. No, this is the Canadian Geeks Chatting Metal, so it's CGCM.
Your timing was bad.
And these are my boys. Yeah, so watch Walligator and the Meister Rich. And they're going to talk, I already watched this, you guys have to see this. It's their recap from Nashville, it's absolutely hilarious. What? Okay, I'm getting...
Static?
I'm getting message from... Oh, I watched. So, please, listen to these guys, they are amazing.
If you watch them, you won't see the damn thing.
If you try to watch...
It'll be like a black screen, yeah, but yeah. You'll
see
like
see, I keep saying watch these guys.
Wave. When they're funny, it'll go really high.
Yeah. And you can watch him. It's just a blank, like, logo. That's all you see. But you can listen.
These guys have faces for radio, though, so this is a beautiful thing.
They're beautiful people.
Yeah.
No, we love these guys. And what do they got? They're talking to Tortora, Jacob Cage, Toby Wright.
Local.
Yep. And they have a... Andy LaFon is in the hot seat this week, and so I met Andy, and I don't think I neglected to mention Andy last week. Yeah, what a great guy. We had such a blast. He's such a fun guy. Really, really great guy. Writer, so he's on Decibel Geek. He writes reviews and things like that, so he's in the hot seat this week for the Canadian Inquisition, which is really easy for me to say. I'll probably be in the hot seat sometime or another, but watch it, love it, because it's one of the funniest bits on podcasting.
Sounds like they drink a lot.
Yeah, they do. They think that we're...
That's so unprofessional.
Yeah, they think we're unprofessional.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Beer-fueled fun. What the fuck?
No, you can even hear beers popping in the background.
That's ridiculous.
I know.
Oh, my God.
That's totally silly. I
mean, that's... Let's, here's to those
here's
assholes.
Those jerks.
Love those
fucking
fuck
guys. Those guys.
All right, we also have the Rock and Metal Combat Podcast. You okay?
I started laughing at right. A good shot.
Mm-hmm. All right. Tell your mom...
Wally, that was rough, Wally.
Tell your mom to go to the store and get more beer.
Why?
Because it's another thrilling episode of the Rock and Metal Combat Podcast. We survived the Rock and Pod Expo 2, and there's an Expo 3 coming up that we just heard about, and it's locked and loaded, but not necessarily in Nashville right now. But holy fuck, it'll be my first, and I'm excited even if it is a year away. So we'll be talking about that every episode.
I can't wait for Rock and Pod 3. Rock and Pod 2 is so much fun, as you know, you guys heard from all the different podcasts and ours. And he'll be with me next year.
Wow.
I'm hoping it's in Nashville, because Nashville rocks. It's a fucking killer city.
All right, so the Rock and Metal Combat Podcast, the most recent one, they're going over and reviewing the old Badlands album.
Wow, what a cool
the
original, album.
Right?
Yeah.
And thanks to Michael Lynch, we discussed the 1989 debut from the supergroup with Jakey Lee and give me somebody else.
No, I can't right now.
Oh.
Yeah.
Who else is in Badlands? A singer, is that
Eric Singer.
Eric Singer. Thank you. Rock and Roll Behind the Glass, Eric Singer.
Thanks. Way back there, Rock and Roll.
Yeah. Great album, though. Man.
Let's talk about...
Wow, did I go blank for a second?
You did. Let's talk about the TV.
Decibel Geek TV?
You can
that's
watch.
Us.
You can watch us.
All right, so not only... There's lots of other stuff.
It's also
us.
On
so
Facebook.
Even if we suck and you hate us, which I know you don't because you love us, and you'll tell us on the Kuhn Brothers at Twitter.
Oh!
As well as...
He made a Twitter thing.
Yeah, I did.
At Kuhn Brothers.
Yeah.
At Kuhn Brothers? Or?
What? No. At the Kuhn Brothers.
The?
I think it's the...
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, it's the Kuhn Brothers.
All right, cool.
It's at
somebody
Kuhn
try
Brothers.
It out and
yeah.
Rag on
tweet
us.
Tweet us.
Be the first one to rag on us. Holy shit.
Yeah.
If you're the first one to rag on us, we'll say your name and do a shot for you on the next
episode.
And maybe
get a tar pick or something.
Yeah. And we're going to do lots of giveaways over the next month, so that'll keep you tuning in. I have so many guitar picks, and I realize I'm not ever going to make any money from them, so I might as well make people happy from them. So I give them away now to people that really want them. Except for my favorites.
He's got like, yeah.
We both have thoughts.
So, D Dio Disciple videos from Rock and Ron are all over the place right now. Blabbermouth's featuring them, and we have them on our Decibel Geek TV channel. Yeah. So, yeah, check out Dio the Disciples, and we're going to have a conversation next week about tribute bands and bands that are not all original. I don't want to call Dio Disciples tribute bands.
We're going to have a huge comment section next week because we're going to ask your opinions about tribute bands, and we're going to have like kind of a poll. It's an
interesting new segment coming up
next week for all you segment freaks.
Also, the 1984 Year in Review, parts 1 and 2, with the rat discussion with Alexi Lalas. And I didn't know who Alexi Lalas was, but Jim, you know who Alexi Lalas is.
Well, that's just because I'm worldly. He was Alexi Lalas, soccer player, one of the football player, one of the greatest American Olympic soccer players ever, and he also played in the MLS, you know, the big soccer league that's in America. And
MLS.
But he's actually one of the biggest rat fans.
ALS.
And it's awesome. And not
ALS.
Nope, that was Lou Gehrig.
Sorry.
He did not play with Lou Gehrig. He was way later than
that. Again, I'm bad with acronyms.
Alexi Lalas, though, you recognize him. He's like red hair, red beard guy. He used to be. Huge rat fan. And anyway, the guy's, there's a great interview that just came back up. With Alexi, talking about Rat with our producer, Rocket Rod. And I'll tell you what. You're going to tell me
something? No, I was just going to say, we saw Pretty Boy Floyd a couple of months ago, whatever it was, and they were filming for videos. So they were trying to get their new video done, and they asked our producer, Rockin' Ron, if he would film some footage, and they're using his footage in their brand new video called We Got the Power. And so that's gonna be really coming up. It's really cool. Pretty Boy Floyd.
Oh, and Blabbermouth.
Great.
And we're supposed to mention that Blabbermouth.
I mentioned Blabbermouth.
That they used Ron's video?
I did, I mentioned that already.
I was daydreaming. I was figuring out where my next shot was coming
that's
from.
That's probably why. And
son of a bitch.
We don't always listen to each other, but we listen to you. So please, get on social media and join our Decibel Geek TV page and at Facebook and on YouTube
at the Kuhn Brothers
on Twitter.
That's ridiculous.
And so the other show we want to talk to you about is a show that we didn't mention last week, and I apologize because I met Baco out at Rockin' Pod, and he was a blast, and he was messing with me, and we had a blast messing with each other, and couldn't be cooler. And his show, along with Loose Cannon, is called Cobras and Fire, and you should be listening to them because they're really good.
And Baco likes tacos.
No, that's what he thinks. Baco, he thinks your restaurant, you should open a restaurant called...
No, I just want a segment.
Baco's like tacos? Baco likes tacos.
Mix it up a little bit. Guacamole this week, salsa.
A little salsa the next week. Yeah. So, they gave us a great idea. They call our camera, when we were on location at Rockin' Pod, they call it the Wang Dang Sweet Kuhn Cam, which I thought was hilarious. If you don't know the Ted Nugent reference, fuck
it's
you.
It's a Ted reference.
Yeah. The only thing I'm really upset about is that they thought that you looked younger than I am.
Well,
they mentioned that on their podcast.
But I am.
Yeah, I know you are, but I thought I looked. We both decided because guess what, folks?
What?
Dyed hair. Dyed. That's fucking all gray.
No, it is not.
It's a wig, actually.
It was a little bit of Just for Men going on.
We appreciate you guys bringing us up on your podcast. You guys are great at what you do, and we appreciate that. And so, cross promotion right here on Decibel Geek TV with our fellow podcasters in the Decibel Geek universe, and that's what it's about.
I prefer family.
Family. Universe. Universe of family.
Yeah.
Hey, so we're back, even though you didn't have a commercial break.
We're back. We did. So speaking of Rockin' Pod.
Rockin' Pod, and next, so speaking of Rockin' Pod, I had the opportunity to interview a lot of
the
really
pleasure
cool rock stars.
Of meeting this man.
And this guy we met before. We met Drew Fortier when he played here in Denver.
You said that very French.
Well, that's how he says it. He says Fortier.
I met Drew Fortier. Back when
he's
came.
Laughing his ass off right now because Drew's a motherfucking funny guy.
No, dude, I don't know if you remember. We did shots backstage. I think it was Bang Tango. It might have been.
Yeah, he played with Bang Tango.
Yeah, it was Bang Tango when he came to Denver, man. We did shots backstage, and your hair was short, and you were telling me how you just quit your job at a as a bartender, man. And thought you were great. You were gracious, and you were really cool to me, and I appreciate it. And now Pete meets you two years later.
We both met him, and then I got to see him again 2 years later out at Nashville Rockin' Pod, and he remembered me, which was insane.
You made believe.
Shut up. But no, he, again.
He probably thought you were me.
The night probably did. We're the same, but to a lot of rock stars. So, really cool guy. And Drew has an amazing book that just came out called Dark, Depressing, Hilarious, His Stories Within the Music Business. And I got to interview him at Rockin' Pod about that book and all his other stuff and crazy shit that was going on with Bang Tango. You need to read this book. If you read rock and roll books.
It's an easy, fast read, right?
Yeah, it's really awesome. Quick. I read it like 3 hours. And I wish it was longer, to be honest with you.
He's a fast reader.
I'm a fast reader, you know, like Evelyn Wood.
Evelyn Wood.
Oh, throwback. Thank you. If you read one really cool rock and roll book, or you read one book at all this year, some of you, this is the one you should probably read. It's a really fun read, and it's great. And this is my interview with Drew at Rockin' Pod, and it was really fun. And though it looks like it, he didn't really kiss me.
Take a look.
So, hey, it's Pete, part of the Kuhn Brothers, with Drew Fortier. I met Drew a couple of years ago, and I just knew him as the guitar player for Bang Tango, and then I found out, wow, he did this documentary on Bang Tango, and that's how he got into the band. That's crazy to me. Elaborate on that, because that's crazy.
Oh, man. So I met Bang Tango at a bar while I was working at a bar. I was bartending, and I happened to have a camera in my hand, and Joel Estay was like, hey, man, what's that in your hand? And I was like, it's a camera. He's like, that's cool, you know, I can find some weed. And I was like, well, back to the camera thing. We're recording an album in 2 weeks in Chicago. You should come out and do like a studio documentary or something. First line's gonna be I was like, I don't know how to do that, but okay.
And so you've never even thought about that?
No. I have no background in filmmaking whatsoever.
Wow. See, that I'm learning things today. That blows me away.
Oh, yeah. And so I did that. I showed up, and they were surprised I showed up. They're like, who's this guy? I was like, I'm the guy from the thing. He's like, he looks like he's supposed to be here, so we'll let him be here. And so I started doing a studio documentary, then I got in touch with the original members of Bang Tango. And the whole story started to come out, and I was like, this would make a good movie. I don't know how to do that, but it'd make a cool movie. So I spent 4 years figuring out how to and how not to make a movie. Lost my mind doing it, and had somehow ended up finishing it, but never getting an official release.
And that's because I saw the song clearance.
Yeah,
song
clearance and all that. But so I ended up just releasing it for free on YouTube. I figured, why not? It's not going to do anybody any good just like, not being out there and just love the fans to see it. Everybody wants to see it. And it's funny, the way you describe the movie is Dark, Depressing, and Hilarious, which is the name of my new.
So let's get talk about that right here.
A terribly selling new book.
So buy it. It's terribly selling. And I think you just gave me a copy. If not, I'll buy it from him. But those buy it.
Plus a 10 for you is, 20.
But, no. Because I make so much money in this podcast thing.
Oh, yeah. That was on me. It was like the Bang Tango movie, but this one's on me.
Oh. So how do you make money? Let's get into that.
No, I actually have a day job. Get this. I wrote this book at my day job.
So that's funny you say that, because one of the segments my brother and I want to do on the show is because, rock stars sometimes, especially ones from that era, you're younger, but the ones from that era, they can't just do that anymore. Or they had a 20-year hiatus where they had to do something else. I mean, I have friends that are painting contractors who are singers of bands. I have friends that, internet guys do websites. And some of them make a lot more money doing their day job than they ever do.
Absolutely. So, yeah, definitely. I work at I remove anti-theft programs from laptops and PCs. So it's like a sit down, I got like a desk and all that. I just kind of have like clients, big clients that like send us their stuff to remove and refurbish and resell. And so I got a desktop, a computer, it's like a computer with Word on it. And then one day I was like, got this expo coming up. What should I do to promote it? Write a book. So it took me 3 days to write that.
3 days?
Yeah.
It'll take me probably an hour and a half to read I'm a psycho reader,
awesome.
I totally can't wait to do that.
That's awesome. I wanted to give people two copies, one to read and one to be like an English school teacher, and it's like, you know, with a red pen.
Right,
like,
okay,
that isn't good grammar. Is that good writing? I'm sure. And then grade it at the end.
Next book, let me know. I'm a third grade teacher. I can at least edit it on third grade.
Yeah, and that'll be on the cover of the book, too. This book is edited
by a third.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh! Yeah. So, tell me more about like the book. Like, you are one of the multi. I would say you are probably the most multifaceted artist in this building because you're a writer. You're a singer. You're a guitar player. You play in a bunch of different bands. You play with Steven, who is sitting over there. You can't see, but Steven from Kick Tracy. And you're also now an actor.
Yeah.
Which I'm going to talk about your movie here in a minute. And so like. How that's crazy to me that you're able to juggle 14 things. So.
One thing led to another. It's just like, I never tried that before. Let's give it a shot. You know, and I also do promo videos for bands too, like Looking Agents and all that. So like,
I saw that. Slaughter and Vince Neil and
everything.
Vince Neil, elaborate on that because that's another thing. It's like all of a sudden it's just word of mouth. And it's like, hey, this guy can do this. He's going to edit.
I never planned on being any kind of editor. You know, after I started doing the Bay Tango movie a couple months after they got done in the studio, I had all that footage. The drummer at the time, Trent Anderson, was like, we need a music video. The album's going to come out soon. We got all this footage. Can you throw something together for us? And I was like, I don't know how to do that, but I'll give it a shot. And I just remember watching, you know, Headbangers Ball when I was a kid, so I know how music videos should flow. And so I just put it together. They loved it. There's a lot of humor in it, you know, especially at the end. The producer is yelling at the guitar player, you know, playing a part right. And it's just a classic meltdown moment. It's genuine and it's hilarious.
Spinal Tap moment.
Exactly.
Love the Spinal Tap moment.
Oh, yeah. And their booking agent saw the video and loved it. And he was like, how would you like to make a little money doing it? And I was like, sure, you know, let me know what you're minded to do. And he's like, you do this deal and slaughter and all that and everything. So, and that led to other people, other booking agents and all that, and other people and all that. Actually, I did a promo video for Frank Camino.
Oh, wow.
A couple years ago, too.
Angel. So, you know, got to see Angel of the Back Together, at least Cranky and Punky. Incredible opportunity. And that's so cool that you hooked up with them, too. I'm looking at the list, and I'm like, who's works with everybody? This guy who doesn't need work with. Now, tell me about the movie. So, there's a movie called Her Name Was Crystal.
Yes.
It's a horror movie, but it's comedy.
Yeah, it's a funny
and
one.
And you're acting in it.
Yeah.
So what do you play?
I'm the comedic relief. I'm the lead's best friend. We work at a sales center, like a sales call center and all that, you know, cubicles and all that. And he's like a lonely, like middle-aged dude, and I, you know, convince him and kind of profile and be like, you know what? Get a hooker. And then and then he's like, I don't know. I'm like, get a hooker. And he's like, okay, he does. He ends up getting a call girl. Then ends up falling in love with her. And then the movie really picks up when he falls in love with her. She's a heroin addict. She dies of an overdose, but he's still in love with her and not ready to part ways.
Wow.
So he keeps her around, and she, you know, in his head, still talks to him and all that and everything.
So it's dark.
It's dark
comedy.
Dark, depressing, and hilarious.
Dark, depressing, and hilarious. All right. So give us a story that doesn't give away, obviously, the whole book, but give us another story from Dark, Depressing, and Hilarious. Like, I can't wait to read this tonight when I get back, or on the airplane when I go home tomorrow to Denver. So
one of my favorites is a Joe Lestay story. I love Joe to death. And he has been sober, and he's been doing amazing. So I know he's gone public with that, so man, he's doing awesome. I love him.
It's great to hear.
Oh, yeah. And a couple years ago, we were at this festival in Minnesota, and I was still doing the movie at the time. It was like 2012. It was a year in doing the movie. And I was on tour with him a little bit, and we showed up at this festival, and Joe and I forgot something at the hotel. And so we're walking, we're going to wait for our escort back to the hotel, and Joe, just being the guy he is, he loves to hold court and make people laugh and all that, he waltzes up to the catering tent and goes, if anybody sees a bad girl with a sore on her lip, she's mine tonight. I looked to my left. The girl running the tent was a large woman with a sore on her lip. He didn't notice that. He didn't realize that. And I was like, Joe, we gotta go right now. And he looks at me, he's like, I just saw we're out of here. So we got the
tent.
that's awesome. But it's one of those classic moments, you know.
I could listen to your story.
Oh, man. All day.
Yeah, that's absolutely.
And actually, I'm going to do a follow-up one, too. Actually, I'm going to do an expanded version of this and expand on a lot of stuff. I wanted to get it out in time for the expo. And that's going to be like a hardcover. Then I'm going to do even more Dr. Brisbane than there.
Tell me about Zen from Mars, which is a project that Drew did with Stevens from King Tracy, who was next to us a little bit ago, and hopefully we can chat with him too. Tell us me about that, because I really like that.
Oh, yeah,
That was cool stuff.
Oh, man. So, 2015, I first joined Bang Tango and started demoing songs for Bang Tango. I was like, you should demo some songs. So I put together some like five fully structured instrumental demos for songs. And it didn't work out with Joe and all that and everything. And so I was talking to Steve Giroux at the time because I was going to be pursuing a Kid Tracy documentary. I sent the demos to Giroux, and he was like, I'm all over that shit. And at the time, I was also pursuing a Fear Factory documentary. And so we became friends with their drummer, Mike Heller. And I told him about the project, and he pretty much elected himself to be the drummer. He's like, I'm your drummer, just so you know. I'm like, all right. And Chip's enough. He's been a friend of mine for a long time, also from Chicago, and so it was a no-brainer to get him involved. His wife, Kate, had Lena, plays keys on it, and then we got Bryn Arns from the band Flip, who's an alter ego of Stevens. He's in the band too, and I actually just joined Flip from the club. I just joined Flip. I play guitar for them too. And,
so what, three bands now?
No, I lost count.
Lost count, yeah.
And that was interesting. And the way I joined Bang Tango, I had just finished the movie and I had a screening in Chicago. Joe Lestay didn't see the movie prior. And it's, and I'm like, oh, I'm kind of nervous, but I wanted to sit by him and see his reaction. So, as he's watching the movie and he's saying stuff on screen, he stands up and he goes, I didn't say that. As he's saying it, it was
adorable. It kind of sounds like our president.
Yeah, exactly. It was fake news. And, but so, then he played a prank on me, and toward the end of the movie, he gets up and storms off, and I chase after him like he's like my girlfriend or something like that. And then, dude, just watch the rest of it, it all makes sense. He's like, gotcha, fucker. And then, sorry, I swear.
Swearing's great.
That's right. Okay.
Now we got that out. Yeah. He's fucking great, by the way.
I think I got Tourette's now.
This will be the Tourette's cast. We'll both just sit here and yell fuck. I'm sorry if you have Tourette's out there. We're not making
fun of
anybody.
That's not very
QC. Yeah. No, we're not making fun of anybody. We are.
That was just fake news right now. That didn't really happen. That didn't happen.
That was pretty
good. That's all you have. Don't rely on this. And then, after you watch the movie, he's like, dude, I really appreciate the honesty. You know, thank you for taking the trip. Then the day after, we were playing a show in Chicago, and Rowan wanted me to play with him for all the songs. And he wanted this. So we're playing a true guitar player band, and Rowan wanted to suck the guitar so he could do his thing. And so then they played with him at the show in Chicago, and Rowan loved it. And then the next show was at M3, and then Joe was there talking about work, like the day before. M3, he goes, how did you know about playing in front of 20,000 people tomorrow at M3? And I was like, I'm renting the car right now, I'm on my way.
Is that the most you've ever played in front of? What's the most amount of people?
That or either M3 or Oklahoma, one was 20,000 or 60,000. But yeah, that was insane. That was just absolutely bonkers. And then, so I ended up joining the band. That relates to what Joe's. I love him so much, but it's kind of like, you know, movie 10?
Yeah.
Whenever he sees his boss at the grocery store, it's kind of like that. So it's like, yeah, like I got through with the movie and all that. And it's like, yeah, you know, there's all this stuff you didn't want to know about yourself. And he's like, you got Moxie, you're in the band.
Wow.
But he didn't say that. It just happened.
It just happened. Yeah. Yeah. But personalities now just kind of meld.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He's a brother. I love Jim. They've got a very interesting relationship, for sure. That's all in the book as well. Very, very sweet, but you'll see.
So, anything we don't know. So, are you doing ballet? I mean, you're an actor. You're a writer. You're a musician. Everything's going on. This guy is as happy of a guy as I've ever interviewed before. I mean, you just seem to love life, and it makes me it makes me feel good, really good inside. But is there anything that I haven't touched on that you want everybody to know?
Oh, Chuck Mosley. I thank you for Chuck Mosley as well.
Yeah, Faith No More, right.
And I'm actually doing a movie on this. That's my next documentary. I know he was a very close friend, and
passed away. If you don't know,
but he passed away. And so me and Doug Esper, his percussionist slash manager slash babysitter, he was we're taking that up to do that and everything. And we love Chuck so much. Last night, we played a show in Indianapolis, and Doug was there, Doug Esper, and we played a Chuck song, did a little Chuck tribute in the middle of the set. And Dave Ellison was there too, because he's been thinking a lot. But we recorded it for a lineup as well. So that's going to be coming after EMP and everything. And so we do like Kid Tracy songs, we do Seth Brown songs, we do a little Chuck tribute and everything.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's going to be really cool. So I just want to give a shout out to, fans of Chuck, fans of Dave Cowboy, we met the world to a lot of people. We love and miss him so much.
No, I can't wait. I can't wait to check out that documentary.
Yeah, it's going to be good. We're really going to be
getting money on this one. You're not putting it on YouTube for free.
And the book, you know what's funny? The book was the last thing I wanted to do with everything that I've ever done. But funnily, it's the first thing that originally got released.
Officially released.
Yeah, right? Like, the movie came out for free. The Zen for Mars thing's been in the making for 3 years. I've been working on the Chuck movie, then everything else. So that's the last thing I wanted to do. It became the first thing I did.
You need to buy the book. It's called Dark, Depressing, and Hilarious, and I'm sure it's all three of those things.
I can act it out for you. Dark, depressing, and
hilarious!
I do like a picture thing, like a stream.
So buy the book, watch the Attack of Life Bang Tango documentary on YouTube for free, be ready for his next documentary, and then the movie, which I can't wait to see. Her name is Krista, so, and it's all in the book, so if you buy the book, it's all in there. And then Bang Tango, Zen for Mars.
EMP Label Group, I work with them, with Dave Ellison and all that.
That's right, I was going to ask you, so you involved in the coffee business?
Distributes
coffee, Megadeth coffee,
Roast coffee. Yeah. Roast coffee. Oh, yeah. I love Ellison. I love Dave so much. And Tom Hayes, one of my closest friends, he's running around.
Oh, cool.
Oh, yeah. And I did a lot of work for those guys. And they we've got a back and forth. Like, they're going to be putting out the GFN album, which nobody knows yet. So that's news right now.
Wow.
But it made sense because I work with them. But,
we just got original.
Yeah, they're the first ones I thought about that. And all kinds of stuff with the live album, the acoustic album, we're doing it's coming after me and everything. And so it's just an amazing relationship with those guys. I love helping them out. Right? It's a great, great relationship.
So cool. True Fourier, what an honor and a pleasure to talk with you. What a blast. Yeah, this is great.
Want to do this again a little bit later?
Yeah, we can. Yeah. Well, actually, I'll drink a little bit. We'll try it again. We'll switch sides. It'll be great. Man, what a blast. I wish you nothing but success. Thank you so much for joining us on our Rockcast.
Thank you so much.
Rock and Rob behind the camera, killing it for us.
Extra, extra, read all about it. Extra.
Welcome back. New segment.
Segment
change. Stop, start. Music news. New segment. So did you see the separation there?
Yeah.
The little juxtaposition?
Yeah, so I've been told you need more separation between segments to differentiate. So prove that we have different segments and we just don't ramble on from segment to segment.
This is our music news segment.
So let's stop for 3 seconds.
Okay, this is our music news segment. And
go for it, Petey. All right. So first thing is about a man called Kingdom Come. If you guys know Kingdom Come, saw them at the
Monsters of Rock.
Yeah, not to be confused with the Monsters of Rock cruise, which is the most amazing thing in the world. But the first Monsters of Rock show had Kingdom Come and Scorpions, Dokken, Metallica, Van Halen.
I think.
Yeah. And so Kingdom Come is back together and they're touring, which is really cool. So guitarist Danny Stagg and Rick Styler, bassist Johnny B. Frank, and drummers James Kotak.
Stop.
Kotak. Is it Kotak
or
Kotak? Yep,
I call him James Kotak.
Okay.
Let me tell you a little bit about James. This is why I stopped you.
Okay.
James Kotak is not only the original drummer with Kingdom Come, but he's also played, I'll grab that, he's played with MSG on the third MSG album with Robin McCauley, and he's also toured with the Scorpions for about the last 15 years.
Yep, and that's really,
you know, what he's been doing forever. Now he's back with the band. Yeah. He decided to reform. Unfortunately, original singer Lenny Wolf's not with the band, not singing with the band, but he's given permission and
he, blessing.
Blessing, that's the right word, to the other new singer to play with them, to sing with them. And I would like to see Kingdom Come. And so the cool thing about this singer...
We did see them on the cruise, actually.
And we did. Yeah. The cool thing about the new singer is his name is Keith St. John. And he played with Montrose.
Yes, that's familiar.
And Lynch Mob. But the reason I know Keith St. John is because he's in a band also who he sings with in Reno, Nevada, from Reno, Nevada, with the Greg Golden band.
And holy shit.
And we were lucky enough to meet Greg Golden on our way to Monsters of Rock.
Our first one.
Oddly enough. Yeah, really.
He met at the airport. Greg's great.
Him and his wife, musician. Totally cool.
Chandra.
Just, yep, beautiful
totally people.
And Greg also plays with Frankie Hannon a lot from Tesla. He sits in on the band a lot. And so we're really looking forward to this. Kingdom Come. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah. It's a connection to some of our folks that we know personally. Yeah. We like that.
Get it on! I sang, sorry.
That wasn't bad, though. That actually wasn't
no
bad.
Singing.
It wasn't oh, I'm getting
bad in the box.
I'm getting word from my producer, no singing. Okay.
That was the control tower, actually. That was...
Oh, DIA.
Something's going on. We'll just ignore it for now.
Delta Flight 6.
Let me give you an Oz... Start over. Let me give you an Oz Fox update, and I won't even look. I know what's going on. He's, I mean, the doctors have cleared him to not necessarily fly overseas, but right now they've cleared him to start playing again. So when Stryper picks up their American tour in October, Oz is going to be back on stage with them, God willing. In the meantime, they do have one of the greatest guitar players ever, Howie Simon. He's filled in, oh my god, he's played with everybody.
Yeah, no, he should.
And he's filled in for everybody, and he's one of Oz's best friends, so this is like a blessing. Oz loves him playing. And go Oz. What's next?
I'm calling this segment Slashing His Wealth.
No.
Half! I'll take half his shit, and they'll get it. They'll get you half your money, your house, your car, alimony, child support, and your children, you'll be on the cover of the Inquirer like this.
Yeah.
I know about this.
This is according to TMZ and other websites, but...
Totally legit.
Which usually tell the truth for the most of the time. You know...
Slash is getting divorced.
Divorced, and he's going to have to pay his wife millions of dollars. Millions of dollars, and she had so much to do with his music, I'm sure. I mean, she probably wrote...
She wrote all of his songs?
All of his songs, was there by his side the entire... No. Not, but...
She actually didn't write any of his songs.
She didn't do shit. And Pearl is getting $6.6 million, along with $100,000 monthly in support. Just for herself, not to mention child support. I'm totally cool with child support. No problem with that. But, come on. $7 million plus $100,000 a month, and you did nothing but fucking fuck this guy for the last whatever. I can't tell you how much this pisses me off.
I'm sure he's not...
I'm not even a huge Slash
fan! I'm sure he's not the nicest guy in the world, Jesus Christ.
Unless he beat her ass or something.
He's not a drummer. So that's in his...
No.
But hold, you went a little bit... went a little bit overboard
It
there.
Makes me angry.
You went a little bit overboard there.
It's just like an athlete, okay? You did nothing to help his career. You married someone for 4 years, and now you're getting half his wealth for the rest of your life. I would totally... the opposite way. If I was married to the richest woman in the world, I would not expect that crap. That's I didn't do anything.
Oh,
you're an asshole.
Yeah, oh no. If I was married to a supermodel, and because of her beauty, I helped her a little bit.
Well, how did you help her?
Because I'm beautiful.
Oh, okay.
So I helped
her. Did her makeup and...
I just
told her how hot she was.
Well, I just stood beside her.
Slept with her.
No, I made her look better by standing beside her.
Okay.
I deserve half her wealth.
Half her wealth. All
right, next.
And then $100,000 a month. Anyway, the kids get money too.
Jesus.
That's okay, but the whole Slash thing pisses me off. Sorry.
Okay, dude, I was reading. AC/DC, actually. I'm not reading. They're going to have some new recordings out. I've never been a huge AC. I keep saying that. All these huge bands... I've never been a big fan of
pretty much.
I've never been a fan
Steel
of
Hard, you know, five bands he likes.
I'm not gonna say the word obscure again because whatever happens, happens. If you guys dig it. If you don't, fuck it. AC/DC, they're coming back. New music from AC/DC. Can we fucking stand it?
But is it new? Is it really new?
No, it's not, because Angus wrote it, and there's actually going to be some shit from his brother. I think actual recordings from Malcolm, even though he passed away recently after a long time from a stroke, a long battle from problems with a stroke and shit, you know what I'm talking about. Yeah, there's issues after a stroke, you know what I'm talking about? He had them, he died. And Angus is playing with him. Tell me more about the recording.
Okay, so the weird thing is this, all this shit's been recorded like over the last couple of years.
Including with Brian Johnson, and so, the vocalist.
Right, and they kicked Brian Johnson out, saying he had an ear, he couldn't hear anymore, whatever the fuck, whatever, they were lying. Because he still plays with Greg Billings' band, friends of ours, and yeah, there's nothing wrong with Brian Johnson's voice or his hearing. They kicked him out for one reason or another, got out Axl Rose. But all this album is with Malcolm Young, who's deceased, R.I.P., part of our dead segment, and with Brian Johnson singing. So they're putting out old AC/DC shit, which is fine with me.
With probably, like, don't pretend Simon whatever, drums.
Right, but don't pretend it's like Simon. New music and stuff like that, and that you're all still together, because you're not going to tour or play this music unless you do it with a cover band.
Or like a hologram. Like the Dio hologram thing.
That's next week's show. Oh, yeah, okay. We're going to talk about that shit next
week. All right, so AC/DC, keep an eye out for the AC/DC stuff. They're in the studios putting that shit together.
And then let's talk about the final thing, which I call Plastic Surgery Episode 2. Episode 1 was Punky Meadows.
From the band Angel.
Jesus.
If you were watching on the last episode, P went to Rockin' Pod 2 and saw up close and personal the band Angel, who's been around for, gosh, 30 plus
73 years.
Yeah, well, it looked like 73 years, and the lead singers had some work done. So that was episode 1. Here's episode 2.
This was totally unplanned episode, but yes. If you look at Vinny Vincent...
There might not be an episode 3 about this.
Vinny's... again,
Vinny Vincent is the subject of this episode.
Yeah, so this is the Vinny Vincent thing.
Tell your story.
So Vinny's gonna play his first concert, supposedly, in 30 years, supposedly.
No, he's gonna play in a couple months.
Right, but no, he's gonna play. It's been up, but the first show he's played live.
Oh!
Yeah, so, hey, don't get me going. Yeah. I know what you're trying to do.
You see what I did?
Yeah. And it's supposed to be, it's in Nashville, and it's at the Graceland Theater. Not that Graceland. It's like a smaller theater.
It's a shithole is what I'm saying.
Okay, it's a shithole.
It's in Memphis at Graceland, but it's a dump from what I understand.
Oh, Memphis. I said Nashville?
You said Nashville, Memphis.
Memphis. Yeah. I get Tennessee mixed up. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Elvis Schmelvis.
Elvis
Pelvis.
You know what? Nashville, Knoxville, they all sound the same to me. Anyway.
Nashville.
We're not huge Vinnie Vincent fans. Now, I saw Vinnie Vincent back when they did the Creatures of the Night
that
tour.
That was a good album.
I think it was Creatures of the Night tour. Yeah, I saw Vinnie Vincent. It was the first time Ace didn't play live with...
It was when he still had a penis.
And so, yeah, he's still kind of, well, that's why we know he likes the makeup. But in any case...
He started the makeup thing.
Vinnie Vincent?
Yeah.
Yeah, before Kiss?
Maybe not. I don't know.
He started the eyeliner makeup and stuff like that when he was not performing with Kiss.
Right, and it grew into crosses and shit. He didn't have crosses.
The funniest thing I read this week was on one of the websites. It was talking about how, which I think is really cool, Ace Frehley is opening up for Gene Simmons' band overseas. So Gene Simmons has got his own band, and Ace Frehley's opening up. So the two of them are hanging out, joking around, talking, and they decide to do an interview.
Respectfully, he's about to get into some more legal problems because he tried to trademark the makeup and to trademark Vinnie Vincent Kiss, the logo.
I heard you only lasted 5 minutes with him on stage.
It was okay. He was sweet for the time on stage, but... There's something called classic failure mechanism, which I was told by doctors and everything. I'm not saying he is one. But there are people who simply cannot handle when things are starting to go their way, success. So they torpedo it by making stupid decisions to make sure they don't succeed so they can deal with that. Because some people just can't fathom being up there. So, you know, they turned off the stuff and torpedo it. And Vinny's a great guy. He doesn't suffer from that.
Good guitar player, too.
Yeah. He's written some
very talented.
Songs.
Yeah. And maybe, in my view, his own worst enemy.
I didn't know if Vinny was going to show up in pants or his dress.
I mean, I hear all these crazy stories. I've
seen photos of him in a dress, so I guess that's how you feel that day.
Growing up, you know, being a Kiss fan and stuff. I thought, it's so cool to see Ace and Gene together, and then to be ragging on Vinnie Vincent, who looks like, you know, my Aunt Clara Mara, or something like that at this point.
We don't have an Aunt Clara Mara,
no,
as far as I know. But if we did,
he would look like just like Vinnie. So,
actually, I hope he can pull this off. Honestly, it's December 7th, I believe. Like, it's 2 days, so 7th and 8th, or 6th and 7th. I don't think it's gonna happen, honestly. Vinny is so shady when it comes to this kind of.
Yeah, he kind of fucked us over at the Rock podcast.
Yeah, he didn't show up at that.
Didn't show up, was supposed to.
But, and here's the big but. If you have VIP tickets, this is a big deal. If you have VIP tickets for this Vinnie Vincent performance at Graceland on December 7th in Memphis. Yeah, it was messed up. After the show, they're having a Vinnie Vincent.
You get a blowjob from Vinnie Vincent. So it's like $99 and you get a blowjob.
No. It's close.
And he's in a dress.
They might actually have that, but no, they're having a Vinnie Vincent gender reveal party.
Oh, Jesus.
Right after the show. And it's gonna make history. It should make music history. Okay.
Our producer has just lost it, so if the camera goes wild, it's not his fault.
If he doesn't cut us off in time, then that's fine. But that'll happen December 7th, and on December 8th, it may be Vicky Vincent.
Vicky Vincent!
You never know, so, Vicky Vincent may be showing up.
And the Vicky Vincent invasion is going
to
hit.
Best of luck to you, Kiss fans! Rob's Rock and Retreat, we know you love Kiss, and Rob, we love you, and we love Kiss, and good luck with the mini thing.
And that's our music news segment for this week on Decibel Geek TV. So I hope you enjoyed that.
We'll have better stuff next time.
Yeah, even better next week. Yeah.
Why don't you sit right back and I may tell you a tale.
It's Bedtime Stories with Jim and Pete. It's a new segment, everybody, for that, like, segment.
Segments!
You see the separation? Okay, we're gonna have a story time.
Story time with Jim and Pete. So,
and we could think of, like, five or six stories, so this could last a couple weeks. So we decided to go with it as a regular segment. So this is our first story, and a lot of them will come from the Monsters of Rock cruise escapades that we've had. And this one comes from one of the West Coast cruises that we've gone on. Actually, the only West Coast cruise that there has been.
We've been on three, and
I was trying to be calm, because it's bedtime stories.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. I'm done. So we've been on three.
You don't have to be an asshole.
No, I
don't know. Don't be patronizing me, just tell them.
Jesus. So we've been on three. Anyway,
the West Coast cruise, we had some of our best friends, as we talked about earlier, on this program, which seemed about 6 weeks ago. It was actually only a couple hours ago. Babylon AD, we were with these guys. Here's the fucking story. All right, it's like 2 a.m, the second night of the cruise. We're all waxed. At least 2 a.m, 3 a.m. We're in the middle of the ocean. Nobody gives a fuck. These guys work in the bars. The bartenders are like native Guatemalans.
Filipino.
I think they were Filipino or Guatemalan.
Yeah, all over the world.
Not very good.
No.
With the English.
Not good with the English.
English is a third language. Anyway, Derek Davis. God rest his soul.
No, he's still alive. And he's the greatest singer in the world.
Derek Davis' favorite drink is
Johnny Walker Red.
Johnny Walker Red.
He drinks Johnny Walker. So we're like, what do you drink? What a Johnny Walker. And so the rest of us are all getting here, and we say, all right, let's get a Johnny Walker Red.
So I go.
I want a double.
I'm like, fuck yeah, let's party. It's 2:30. Let's keep this going. So I say to the bartender from Guatemala, I want a Johnny Walker double.
Johnny Walker Red double.
And give me a Crown and Coke and my brother a Crown and Coke. And all of a sudden, we all get our drinks, and Derek, like, screams, what the fuck is this? And I tasted it. I'm like, what the fuck is this? And it was Red Bull.
It was Red Bull.
It was Red Bull.
It was
like
Red Bull, Johnny Walker. It was Johnny Walker
and Red Bull.
With Red Bull.
That's what it was. Johnny Walker and Red Bull.
So he thought, you know, he said double, and it was
Red Bull. And that so was like, I said to the nice guy behind the bar, I said, I'm sorry, you misunderstood me.
No, you didn't say it like that, but
I said, sir.
Let's pretend.
I said, sir, nice sir, you misunderstood me, sir.
No, you didn't.
I didn't say a double Red Bull, Johnny Walker Red Bull. I said Johnny Walker Dub Bull, not Johnny Walker Red Bull. And he disagreed with me.
Yes, he did.
He threw me
very angry. He got very angry. He wanted his drink tickets.
Yeah, I got angry. And then there's a friend of mine named Jimmy, who might be watching this or might not be watching this, who got very angry with me.
Jimmy's involved with the band as well.
He's a brother,
amazing, fun guy.
And so there's Jimmy and me. And I think maybe the drummer and the guitar player got involved.
Could have been a couple of band members.
And we were ready to throw overboard, plank, what is the word? I don't know. It was
what
bad.
The fuck? Oh,
it
God
was
damn, we were ready to kill this guy.
I was like, I don't give a fuck. Just but give me the so, right drink. I don't care what you thought you
so
were.
So here
just
we are
give me the right
with
drink.
Our favorite oh my band, God. One of our favorite bands in the world. And
they're seeing the worst side.
They're seeing, no, we just don't want them to get thrown off the cruise. We just don't want them to get in trouble. So like, we're starting to argue
we're
with them,
taking
like,
all
guys,
the
you move back.
I'll take
know,
the heat.
We'll take the heat. And he's like, you didn't get a fuck. He didn't order that fucking shit. We're screaming.
Out of control.
Managers are coming over.
Finally, a woman who spoke English gave us a free drink.
Free drink. Calmed everything down.
And walked away.
The band was fine. We were fine.
And but, we laughed about it for years to come.
But I will never forget the Red Bull.
Johnny Walker
Derek
Red Bull.
Davis,
Derek.
Story.
Sean, Derek, we love you.
We love you guys. Sean and Derek. And
Derek, that's our story. Everybody, we have better ones that we won't tell.
No, we will tell.
Not for Sean.
Well, we finished this bottle tonight, so there's things we won't tell.
I won't tell Sean.
But just because we don't want to embarrass. But thank you for listening to our
bedtime
story.
Good night, folks. Sleep well.
Man, we want to thank you for joining us for our second episode. I know our first one got banned, but it's back up, so watch it if you haven't watched it. And then number two for Decibel Geek TV. I just love hitting this fucking wall. Please join us for our second episode. It's really fun to do this for you guys.
It is fun. You know,
we just got to our second show, and so there's so many things we still want to share with you guys about stuff.
The Kuhn Brothers Rockcast. That's what we are.
That's what we
follow
are.
Us on Facebook. Decibel Geek TV.
Obviously, Decibel Geek TV, YouTube, Facebook, and then we're at the Kuhn Brothers.
God knows Twitter. What they're gonna fucking ban us for next. So watch us soon.
You know, watch us as fast as you can because you don't know after like 2 days they're ban us for something, which is great publicity. Except that we lose all our views and we lose all our numbers. So please join us again next week. We had so much fun tonight. Thank you so much for
next
watching
week?
Us. Next week.
All right, we'll
I can't
see
wait,
you then.
Man. Next week can't come too soon. Love you guys. Thank you for tuning us in. We're the Kuhn Brothers.
Yeah.
We're on Decibel Geek.
I have no choice.
TV on YouTube and all those other platforms.
See you, bud.
See y'all.